something I have come to learn quickly about dads. I've had a dad my whole life. I've had a dad my whole life, and I've been a dad now for over 5 years, because my oldest is 5.5 years old. So I've come to learn things about fatherhood that while I can read about, learn about, hear about, there's some things that just that experience is a little bit different. Like I found out that really bad jokes is in the fatherhood DNA. There's something about being a dad that brings about really stupid jokes. And I don't know where it came from. I don't know. My daughter Ziva comes up to me and she says, "Daddy, I'm hungry." And know what I reply with? "Hi, hungry, how you doing?" That's what I do. And she's five, but she still does the teenager, "Oh." She rolls her eyes and gives a sigh. "Oh." And then she replies with, "Daddy, my name is Ziva, and I want food in my tummy." And so she explains it to me in more detail. And I've come to realize, I started thinking about it, my dad did this too. He did stupid stuff. My dad, I'd go up to him, and I'd say, "Hey, Dad, did you get a haircut?" And he would say, "No, I got them all cut." And just... you know, this is what happens. And so I have come to discover that there's something in the dad DNA. So I did a polling online and on Facebook and on Twitter and on Google+, and I did a polling on what were some of the best dad jokes you ever ran across or had to be subjected to. And so I got the Walking Dead parenting here of Carl and Ricky, and Carl the son. And so here's a conversation. We're going to make our own memes of bad dad jokes for a moment here, just so you can kind of see the funness that people have had with dads. So know that it's not just me. It's not just the coin mutated DNA that loves puns. That has existed all throughout the spectrum of fatherhoods everywhere, our associate pastor included. Okay, and so, like, for example, maybe your dad and you have had this type of conversation where he says, "Hey, Dad, I'll call you later." And the dad says, "Don't call me later. Call me Dad." Yeah, right? You know, you've had that moment maybe with your parent like that, or "Surely you didn't mean that." Huh? "I do, and don't call me Shirley." Okay. So you've had, you know, or maybe dad just come up and they'll just say the most random things to you. Something like, "I used to hate facial hair, but then it grew on me." That one maybe, that's a circle joke, right? You'll laugh when you get around to it. You know, but nonetheless, or maybe something along the lines of, I think I bought my shoes from a drug dealer. I don't know what they're laced with, and I've been tripping all day. And so on and on. It's funny. Why do the drug jokes go better across our group than any other joke? I'm trying to figure this out. Everyone loves the drug jokes. Anyway, but that seems to be the fatherhood DNA there. It just seems to be in there to do that. But here's the thing I want you to get, is that we're going to be going through the book of Acts, and we have been for like 2 years going through the book of Acts with a small break in the middle of the book of Esther. And we're going verse by verse through the book of Acts. We're working through this, hammering this book out. And I want you to also hear fatherhood in this passage. I'm going to be honest with you. This passage is weird. This passage is bizarre. This passage has confused scholars for centuries. And Christians have, with good intentions, and I want to repeat that, Christians have, with good intentions, misquoted this passage time and time again. In fact, you can go online and buy novelty items that misquote this passage. And they have a good heart. The people have a good heart. And I know that they have good intentions, but we're going to learn the context here and what's happening. And because this passage is so difficult, and I'm going to try to stretch it into fatherhood principles, we're going to go through all the verses twice. Okay, we're going to read them, all of them in order up front, and then we're going to break them down with me kind of giving you more of an abbreviated version of the verses so we can kind of get an idea of where we are and where we're going with it. So let me read the whole thing for you, starting at Acts chapter 19, starting at verse 8. We're going to go all the way to 20. Check this out, starting at verse 8. "Then he," who, Paul? "Then he," yes, Paul, "entered the synagogue and spoke boldly over a period of 3 months, engaging in discussion and trying to persuade them," the people in the synagogue, "about the things of the kingdom of God. But when some became hardened and would not believe, slandering the way in front of the crowd, He, Paul, withdrew from them and met separately with the disciples, conducting discussions every day in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. And this went on for 2 years, so that all the inhabitants of Asia, both Jews and Greeks, heard the message about the Lord. God was performing extraordinary miracles by Paul's hands, so that even face cloths or work aprons that had touched his skin were brought to the sick, and diseases left them, and evil spirits came out of them. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists attempted to pronounce the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, "I command you by the Jesus that Paul preaches." Seven sons of Sceva, yes, that's actually pronounced Sceva, not Sceva or anything like that, it's Sceva, and the seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. The evil spirit answered them. This is where the seven sons of Sceva had said, "Come out of you, come out of that person, demon." And so the evil spirit answered them, "I know Jesus, I recognize Paul, but who are you?" Then the man who had the evil spirit leaped upon them, overpowered them all, prevailed against them, so that they ran out of that house naked and wounded. Really funny scene, really is. This became known to everyone who lived in Ephesus, both Jews and Greek. Then fear fell on all of them, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many who had become believers came confessing and disclosing their practices, while many of those who had practiced magic collected their books and burned them in front of everyone. So they calculated their value and found it to be 50,000 pieces of silver. In this way, the Lord's message flourished and prevailed. Now, these are these verses. Odd passage, right? Really odd passage, because what's going on here is that we have this weird moment to where it sounds like Paul is acting a little bit like Jesus. Remember that lady that touched Paul's robe and how Jesus felt his energy flowing from him, and she got healed from her bleeding just by touching his cloak? And Jesus is like, "Who touched me? Who touched me?" Because he noticed that someone touched his cloak. Okay, so something similar is happening here with Paul, where even a hanky was healing people and driving out demons. Very odd passage. And then we get a reversal of things, because usually a demon-possessed man strips himself naked and then has to be cast out, but here a demon-possessed man strips the exorcist naked and cast them out. And so it's like a reversal of things. It's just a really weird passage. And this is so appropriate for Father's Day. No, not because your children are like little demons, though it may seem like that at times, but and that the goal of the parent is to cast the kids out. You're a grown up. Get out, you millennial. Get out. No, it's not that at all. It's something very, very different we're going to see. But let me recap for a moment here briefly, very briefly, because we got so much to cover. Paul is on his third missionary journey. He had already shaved his head, took his hair, brought it back to Jerusalem, offered it on the fire, and then he went from Jerusalem back to Ephesus. And when he was in Ephesus, he ran across some disciples that I believe were from Apollos while Apollos was there, before Apollos got corrected by Priscilla and Aquila. And as Priscilla and Aquila were teaching Apollos, Apollos got corrected, got better equipped, left that area, and went out toward Corinth. Meanwhile, some disciples were still not knowing fully the information of Jesus and his baptism. So Paul appears in Ephesus and teaches them, corrects them, helps them become more mature into their faith, and helps them become Christians, and he really gives them the full picture. So now, from there is where we have left off, is he dealt with Apollos' disciples. Well, now Paul's going to the synagogues, and he's teaching, and while he's teaching, he ends up dealing with obstinate people. They didn't want to hear about Jesus. They didn't want to hear about any of that. They started slandering it, talking smack about it, and just putting it down. And so Paul says, forget this. I am leaving. I'm going to go to the lecture halls of Tyrannus. And the word lecture hall is a Greek word that's actually skolēs. We get the word school from it. And so Paul ends up going to a school, and he teaches in that school for 2 years. Okay, so that's a little bit of what's happening here. But before we dig into this and get into the issues of fatherhood that we can glean from this passage, we do have a theological issue we have to hammer out. And that is this issue of Paul and his hanky, okay? This is the issue of Paul, who has suddenly been, it seems like, the way some people treat it, he had a wireless microphone and a hanky, and whenever he swept his brow from his excited preaching and then dropped it, people would grab it and then go around saying, we can heal people, and it worked. Okay, and it worked, and it's just messed up, and it's like, what? You know, and all the millennials went, what? And that's just how it worked. It just was so weird. And so then, good, well-intentioned Christians have been trying to duplicate this really weird event. And this event was so weird, so unique, that even the Bible talks about it in weird ways. Like, hey, even this was happening, and this was amazing, so that the name of God was glorified. And anyone who tried duplicating it got the tar kicked out of them. Literally. Okay. Anyone who tried duplicating it, that's when the demons were like beating on the exorcist and kicking them out of the house and stripping them naked along the way and laughing at them. You know, having a big old Dwayne Johnson Central Intelligence moment. Ha ha ha, look at the naked kid. You know, that's kind of what was going on here. It was just this really weird thing. Okay, and here's what Christians tend to do. I've run across this personally, where someone mailed someone in our church a card, and on the card had a cloth in it that was cut like this, because apparently the jagged edges are more holy, and it was called a prayer cloth, and they said that if you put this cloth in your shoe or on your body for a period of time, you will be healed of your celiac disease. That's what was told to someone in our church, and they came, and then they cited Acts chapter 19 as their proof text. So someone in the church came to me and they're showing me this card, this get well card. We heard you're sick, heard you have celiac disease. Well, the Holy Spirit's in this cloth, just like it happened with Paul. And if you wear it and touch it and rub yourself with it, you will be healed of this and all will be great. And so they asked me, they said, I read this passage, and the passage they read really seems to seem that this would work. To which I said, well, read on. And they're like, what? I'm like, yeah, read beyond those verses that they cited. Just read like five verses later. And so they read on. They saw where the demons said, I don't know. I know Jesus. I know Paul. Don't know you. And they kicked the tar out of them and left them naked. And I said, now, if you put this cloth upon your child is not going to be stripped naked and cast out into the street. That is not, because this is descriptive, not prescriptive. And that this shows, the whole purpose of the story is to show that it's the power of the Spirit that was doing this, not the cloth, not the hanky. Because even the people who tried doing the similar things as Paul were failing. So if they're failing, clearly it's not the object. Clearly it's the one of whom is using the object, which is Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And let me just tell you, I have to feel sorry for the exorcisers in this story that get stripped naked and kicked out of the house. Because think about it. If a face cloth outperforms you, you're going to have a bad day. You know, if you have an apron and you go into the kitchen and it cooks better than you, you're going to have a rough day. You know, you just know it's going to be bad for you. And so these guys are looking at this situation going, hey, even cloths are healing people. Surely we can do this too. So they went and they tried it and lost miserably. And they're like, man, why can the cloth do it, but we can't? And that's what the Bible is trying to say. It's not the cloth. It's not even the person like a human being. It's God and it's the Holy Spirit. That's why this is happening, because the Holy Spirit is choosing to allow this piece of face cloth that was wrapped on Paul's forehead or around his head, something to soak up sweat. The Holy Spirit decided to allow this cloth to be an ambassador for the gospel in Paul's absence, because he could not be everywhere all at once. And so that God knew that if the cloth did miraculous things, everyone's going to want to go to where the cloth came from. And when they find Paul, what are they going to get? The gospel, not someone saying that they're special and they got power. They're going to find the gospel. And so that's what the Holy Spirit was doing. So it's the descriptive, not prescriptive thing. So hopefully that kind of helps with some of this theological issue that's going on here that can seem really bizarre. And it's not new, because often when Paul starts a new missionary journey, both times we find very miraculous things happening to allow the lost people to see Jesus-like parallels happening. to where what Jesus did in history, for real, Paul is also doing similar things so that people know that, hey, this points to Paul, this points ultimately to Jesus, it's the gospel. Okay, so it's that type of an issue there. So Paul finds that when he starts a new missionary journey, you find talking in tongues and you find gifts of healing, you find Pentecostal type things, because it's all trying to point back to that, because they still don't have the gospel yet or the whole Bible yet. They haven't gotten it all written down. They're still living it. You know, it's not like Spaceballs where you can go and pop in a VHS tape, fast forward to the present and say, this is the now. You know, that's not what they're dealing with here. They're dealing with the fact that it hasn't been written yet, okay? And so now Luke is writing it down, but it has already happened, and so he's writing it down. So this is it's a rough theological issue. So hopefully it's cleared up now. So now we can move forward. And we're going to look at four different elements of fatherhood principles that we can glean from these really goofy passages. Okay, and this is going to be a lot of fun. We're going to learn about a father's passion. We're going to learn about a father's reliance, a father's discernment, and a father's life or legacy. So this is the approach we're going to take, and here are the verses we're going to be using for it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to re-put up the verses on the screen for you, but they're going to be abbreviated and semi-paraphrased because, you know, they took up a lot of slides. And I want each of these verses, even 13 to 17, to fit on one slide, and I could make it really small words, but then we couldn't read it. Especially the people on the video would not be able to read this at all on YouTube. And so I'm going to make it as big a font as I can, so I've abbreviated. So that's why I'm giving you the heads up, just in case you go, it says more than that. Yes, you're right, it does. You have a Bible, open it up, read it. Yes, it says more than that. We already covered all of it. Now I'm just going to give you the highlights as we move forward. So, a father's passion from verses 8 through 10, where we find that Paul entered the synagogue, spoke boldly over a period of time, but some would not believe. So he withdrew and he taught in the school of Tyrannus for 2 years until everybody possible could hear of the Lord in that area. Okay, so this is the father's passion. And let me just kind of share this with you. A father's passion is to be Jesus. Okay, a father's passion and his message is to be Jesus. And his time is valuable, therefore don't waste it. Okay, so a father's passion is supposed to be Jesus. First and foremost should be Jesus. And because his time is valuable, it must not be wasted. What does Paul do when people were just questioning rather than asking questions? What does he do when people are just basically being casting pearls amongst swine? They're a waste of time. What does he do? Does he keep working with it or does he go someplace else? He goes someplace else. There's a time and a place to say, no, I'm done with this. I'm not wasting my time with this. I'm going to try to work in a different way. And so when you're looking at ministry, you're looking at life, and you're trying to deal with people, if they are wasting your time, then don't waste it. Leave that situation, because your time with your family is valuable. It's valuable. So don't waste it. All right? And here's the thing. Notice that Paul, he doesn't stop. Just because they wouldn't listen to the preaching, he doesn't stop preaching. Where does he go? A school. Because Paul is totally pro-education. Paul is totally about being involved in the education of people. He could have just gone to the city squares. He could have gone to a corner and stood on a soapbox. He could have just started, you know, social media blasting. You know, but they had bad reception in that area. You know, so he goes to a school. And here's something interesting. Ephesus had about seven schools that are widely known and excavated. It looks like there was a few more. They're working on some excavation still, and there might be some more schools that have been there. I've said time and time again that ancient Roman culture is almost identical to modern American culture. And here we find that the ancient Roman culture, they had schools for boys and girls, predominantly boys, and of the schools you would attend until you were in your late teens, around 17, 18 years old. When do we usually go to school till? Predominantly 17, 18 years old. Isn't that interesting? And then when you're done with that school, if you wanted higher secondary education, you could go to college. They had college back then. Isn't that interesting? They had seminaries. Okay, it was just interesting, the education that they had and how pro-education that they were. So when you got done around 17 with your education, if you wanted to be a lawyer or a philosopher or a councilman or whatever, you could go to secondary education and then work your way up. Okay, and so Paul goes and he's teaching at the schools. And it's neat that he brings the disciples there, and it's kind of in this public lecture hall. And the school classrooms would be anywhere, seats would be available from 30 to 120 students, depending upon how many teachers in the city, how big the city was. They would have up to 120 students. And so Paul goes to this particular school of Tyrannus, and our translation here of the Homan does it as lecture hall, because it was kind of how it was formatted. That was its structure. It was all grades, all ages in one hall. Here it is. Boom. Okay, kind of like our schoolhouses of old, right? Where you hear about the small countryside schools where everybody's kind of shoved into one classroom of different ages, all the way from first grade to seventh grade, or just kind of all right there. That type of a situation. So there is in that lecture hall. And this is so appropriate that Paul is so pro-education. So hear this, fathers. The Bible repeatedly says, dads, be pro-education. Even all the way back into Moses' writing, like in Deuteronomy 6, where it says, these words that I am giving you today are to be in your heart. Repeat them to your children. Talk about them when you sit in your house and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Okay, it's this constant, this should be this passion of dads to be involved in their kids' education. When they go to school, when they come home, find out what they're learning and make sure you add and bring into it the Christian worldview into it, talking about scripture, talking about the triune God of the Bible, being involved in that. Here's how I do this with my kids. This is really fun. So Ziva, this is just in the past 8 days, okay? Just in the past 8 days, I'll give you two illustrations here of teaching my kids a Christian worldview despite everything else that's going on in life. So my daughter comes up to me and she says, Daddy, will you play Barbies with me? Okay, so and if you're a good dad, you're going to play Barbies with your daughter. Okay, now sometimes I have to, I tell her, not right now, Daddy's going to finish this, then we can play. So I'm like, yeah, let's go play Barbies. So I go down to her room and we're going to play Barbies. I'm like, okay, cool. So what's the story? I always ask her, what's the story? Because I want to play like she wants to play, not like I want to play. Because if I want to play like I want to play, Barbie's going to turn into an alien and she's going to be an android and my daughter's going to cry. And so I've learned, she's like, no, my Barbie's not a robot. It's a Barbie. So I've learned, what's the story? And she tells me, well, this Barbie, this you're the daddy. I'm like, oh, he's a daddy? Well, he's getting married, so he's about to be a daddy. And I'm like, well, hopefully there's some time in between the marriage and the daddy part. That's what I'm thinking. I'm just like, okay, let's see where this goes. And so she says, they're going to get married. Here's the lady he's going to get married to. This is the mommy. This is going to be the mommy of the family. And here's the pastor. I'm like, okay, cool. So she said, we're going to do the wedding. She already had them dressed up, but she had taken the clothes off and put new clothes on them. The male Barbie is in this nice little tux thing. It was brown because she doesn't have a black one, but it was all dressed up and looking spiffy, and the Barbie had her fanciest dress on. She's all excited, and here's the pastor. Pastor was naked. I don't know if I'm officiating her wedding. But anyway, I just hope that view changes. And so she's like, here's the pastor. I'm like, okay, cool. So I had the pastor, and she goes, okay, Daddy, you start. I'm like, okay, cool, I'll start. So I had the pastor doll talk to the daddy doll, the other man getting married doll, and I asked him, how do I know you're going to be a good husband to this woman? And the daddy doll said, well, what would you like to know? So I said, the pastor doll said, well, first, do you love Jesus? And so Ziva's just having the doll, like her doll, listening. She's moving it closer, like this, sideways, with her ear aimed in. She's curious now. So I'm like, so do you love Jesus? Yes, I love Jesus. How do I know you love Jesus? So he starts talking about how he loves the Lord, accepted him as Savior. I laid the gospel out, all right? It was fun. And then he goes to church and worships God and wants to be able to have a good godly wife, to be able to raise godly children who love God. And so I said, okay, cool. So you love Jesus. Excellent. And then she goes, yay, we can have our wedding. And the pastor says, oh, not yet. I have one more question. And the pastor turns back and says, oh, do you have a job? What do you do? How long have you worked there? And can that job provide for the family? And so he says, yes, I've been working as, and I said, he's been working as, and I'm thinking. And Ziva said, toilet builder. He builds toilets. Okay. He owns a toilet factory, and he builds toilets. I owned a toilet factory, and I build toilets, and I've been doing this for 7 years. And is, and then so and I had the pastor say, because no Jesus, no job, no joining. Okay, so then they go and they begin to get married. And so this was a great little teaching moment, right? And then I heard later, Ziva was doing another wedding all by herself. I'm cooking a little bit. And I heard Ziva say, no Jesus, no job, no joining. You can't marry me because you don't love Jesus enough. And had this little quarrel of the, so it's getting there. It's getting there. But see, that's the thing, is that teaching thing. And although I will say, second story. I told you to be two. I love this other one because this happened just a couple days ago. And it was, I right after it happened, I went, okay, Ziva, daddy's going to go write something down. But I threw a monkey wrench into the whole thing. And so she said, okay, daddy, you want to play Barbies with me? So, you know, good dad. Okay, I'll play Barbies again. And I'm sitting down. And it wasn't a wedding this time. It was, okay, I want to marry you and I want you to be a daddy. And I want to have, she said, her Barbie said, I want to have 11 kids. Okay. You know, and then she says, well, let's get married so we can have our family. And I said, wait a minute. What if we don't have the same goals here? She goes, but we're going to get married. We're going to have 11 kids. And I had the male Barbie say, but I don't want to have any kids at all. And then Ziva just went. She almost started tearing up a little bit. She just was all confused. And then she's like, yes, you do. We have kids. That's what we do. And I said, I don't want kids. I don't want to have kids. And then she said, why? And I had the daddy Barbie say, because I don't know how to be a dad, and it scares me. And she said, oh, well, then let's not get married yet, and let's go find some families and let you learn how to be a dad. And you can watch them being a good dad, and then you can learn how to be a dad. She said, but I don't need to do that because I already know how to be a mom. And so then she, Ziva quick, like, put the Barbie down, went and got some more dolls and put them together. And she said, okay, this is a good household. There's a good daddy. Live with them for a while. Learn what it means to be a dad so we can get married and have kids. But anyway, this is the thing, though, okay, is that we can teach our kids. And that should be the passion of a dad, to teach our kids how to think and let it be centered in the Christian worldview. Not saying that not having kids is the appropriate thing, but just trying to let her know you don't just get married just because. You really got to think things through, and I'm trying to teach her and work with her and try to help her to develop and grow. And I want her to love Jesus so much that the passion ends up turning all our playtime into a Pixar cartoon. Okay, it's just that level of quality of writing and storytelling seems to be going on. So that's the passion. That's the passion. So hear that. And it shouldn't just be dads. Moms can play like that too. You know, moms can be able to get involved into the children's education. Moms can be able to get involved into teaching the Christian worldview to their children, talking to them about the Bible. In fact, every night I make sure that Ziva has a Bible story read to her out of her own Bible. And we got a new devotional that we bought. It's really short, called a kid's devotional. And we have both her and George. George is two, so his attention spans a whole lot less. And so we bring them both our kids through that. And so we're working on it and trying to help our kids grow in Christ and know about God. And Ziva's already been talking to me about how she loves Jesus. She wants to read. She wants to read so bad. She goes, Daddy, I'm tired of all the work it takes to read. Can't I just read already? I'm like, sure, here. And she goes, I can't read. And she wants to read. I said, why do you want to read so bad? She said, because I want to read the Bible so I know how to better please God. That's what she told me. And she's five. Okay, so this is the thing. Should be what that's my goal for my kids, is to just love Jesus like that. And so that should be the goal of every parent, is to love God. Okay, so that's the father's passion. And that's what we see in Paul. What was his passion? For people to love Jesus, to bring the broken at the feet of the Savior. That was Paul's passion. Okay. The next part here to look at is the Father's reliance. Father's reliance. So God was performing extraordinary miracles by Paul's hands, so that even faith cloths or work aprons that touched his skin were brought to the sick, and diseases left them, and evil spirits came out of them. Okay, really weird passage. Father's reliance. A father needs to rely upon the Holy Spirit for his significance and his effectiveness. Okay, a father and a parent in general needs to rely upon the power of the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus Christ for his significance and his effectiveness. Because in the end, no matter what you do, you need that. You need the Holy Spirit to have any type of impact or effectiveness. You really do. Okay, you need to rely on the Holy Spirit. And here's what parents want to rely on, dads especially. They want to rely on their job. They want to rely on their income. They want to rely on their handiness. They want to rely on their computers. They want to rely on whatever skills they have. And then they want to have the Holy Spirit anoint that, not to rely on the Spirit. Okay, it's like the Spirit becomes a means to an end. It's, I will want the Spirit as long as the Spirit anoints what I'm passionate about, rather than I need to rely on the Spirit for everything. Okay, and this is why. Because our world teaches and reinforces a methodology that says that your worth, your significance, your identity is rooted in two things, form and function. What you look like and what you do. In fact, when I teach psychology classes at both Grace Bible College and also at Cornerstone University, when I teach psychology classes there, I'll put form and function on the board, and I'll have the question, how do you define a human being? How do you know what a human even is? How do you know you're looking at a human and not a giraffe? How do you know? Okay, how do we know? What does it mean to be human? And always I'm able to take all their answers and catalog it amongst these two columns, whether it's having opposable thumbs that goes in form, whether it's having a certain type of humanoid type look and structure that goes under form, whether it's having, in fact, I can even give you a little glimpse what sometimes this looks like, briefly speaking, you know, having complex language, having social contributions, advanced mechanics, and on it goes. And so whatever they come up with always seems to fall in either how we look or what we do. And then I have to ask the really tough question. If somebody is born and they are deformed, somebody's born and they don't have the proper form, if you will. Maybe they're born without thumbs or without arms. Maybe they're born unable to look like a human, or something happens to them and they don't look like we would say is the form of a human. Are they still a human being? Resoundingly, without hesitation, the whole class goes, yeah. Absolutely, yeah, they're still human. So, okay, cool. Now, if a human were to become disabled and could not do the function, they couldn't have the complex language or even the ability to speak, if they were unable to provide a social contribution due to paralysis or in a catatonic state, or whatever the case may be, they aren't able to have the function appropriately, are they still, despite their disabilities and handicaps and inabilities, are they still human? To which people say, with resoundingly, without hesitation, absolutely, absolutely. And I said, so in other words, you're telling me that all your definitions of humanity are void. So what does it mean to be human? Because everything they gave me over that period was about form or function. If neither one actually defines a human, then they aren't what defines a human. So then they haven't answered the question. So then I ask them, then what does it mean to be human? To which they get stumped time and time again. To which then I have to bring about, let's start with Genesis. What does it mean to be human? They said, well, made in the image of God. I'm like, okay, there is a good place to start. We tend to start with form and function. We don't start with the Holy Spirit. We don't start with Jesus Christ. We don't start with God the Father. We don't start with the triune God of the Bible. We start with where society has. And that's as far as society can go. Because they're trying to remove God from the equation. Remove God from the equation, you lose exactly what it means to be human. Do you notice that? And what society reinforces time and time again is for dads to find their meaning, their significance, and their identity apart from God. That's what society is wanting. Society is wanting us to be like the sons of Sceva, to do it on our own power, our own ability, our own methods, our own attitudes, our own whatever, and not to rely upon and be focused on, identified by the triune God of the Bible. And a father's reliance needs to come from the Lord, period. and that gets lost. And I can't tell you how often it is so difficult it is for dads to break from this. Because they end up living their life and they hit 60s and 70s, look back upon their life with regret because they look at how they didn't function the way they wanted to, and they look upon how they didn't get the goals they wanted to, and how they go through midlife crisis, meaning they didn't achieve what they wanted to achieve. And it tends to be based upon things that have nothing to do with the Holy Spirit. It tends to be, well, I should have taken that job instead of this one, or I should have married so-and-so instead of this one, or I should have had kids or more kids or less kids, you know, and they have all this regret, and yet it's like you're still relying on form and function. You're not relying upon the power of the Spirit, because if you're relying on the power of Spirit, you wouldn't look at the past with regret. You would look at the past and say, hey, I know where I screwed up, but that doesn't mean I have to keep screwing up today. Doesn't mean I have to get all depressed and worked over about what I messed up before. It means I can start getting it right now, because as long as there is breath in your lungs, the Holy Spirit can still work through you. If nothing else, to be able to teach people how to end the race in a way that honors God, which is one of the things I told one of our oldest members right before he died. He had told me, he said, in his, one of his most able to speak moments, he said, I can't speak well, I can't think well, I can barely pray, I don't know what my purpose is anymore. And I told him that he has shown a life of what it means to live a godly life, and now he can show what it means to end the race in a godly way and be faithful all the way to his last breath. And that is a lesson only the elderly can teach. That is a lesson only he could teach. And it could not be taught by a book, it cannot be taught by a movie. It has to be taught by a person, what it means to end the race well. So I told him, you keep fighting, you keep struggling, and you show us how to end with your faith intact. Show us how to, what it means to cross that finish line with gusto for the Lord. And that's exactly what he did just a couple months later. That's the thing about the Father's reliance. If it's upon the Spirit, your significance lasts until your last breath. Your identity lasts until your last breath, regardless of your employment, regardless of retirement, regardless of your ability or how you look or what you can or cannot any longer do. I noticed that there are things I can't do anymore. I'm a young guy. I'm 40 years old, but I noticed that I get exhausted on a trampoline faster than I used to a decade ago. I noticed that. My daughter would be like, Dad, jump with me. I start jumping with her, and we're jumping. And about after 15 minutes, I go, oh, Daddy needs a break. She goes, Daddy, come on. And I'm like, oh, Daddy's going to die. Okay, Daddy needs a break. She's like, Daddy, you're not that old. Oh, Daddy's feeling it right about now. You know, I used to be able to go on the craziest spin-around rides at the fair. I went on one Tilt-A-World ride with my daughter and about threw up and was sick for the rest of the night and couldn't even walk straight. And I'm like, when did this happen? Last year I was fine. This year I'm getting, you know, I can't do that anymore. And I could get depressed. I could get all sad and worked up if my reliance was upon my function. My reliance isn't upon my function. I just looked at that as, hey, that's a chapter of a life that has page that has turned, and that's okay. Because I have so many other things I can offer and still teach my daughter about Jesus with. I don't need a Tilt-A-Whirl for that. So I'm not able to do the things I used to be able to do. That's okay. I don't have to. You know, my son used to find, we still find it endearing sometimes when my son puts his food in his hair, but that's a chapter of my life that has turned. It's not cute when I put food in my hair, you know, and that's okay. And so same thing with this other thing, but if our reliance is on our function, we're going to get depressed. I used to be able to, but now I can't. I used to be able to, but now I can't. What good am I? Like the Holy Spirit is limited to your ability. That's the whole significance about the face cloths. Paul didn't even have to do anything but sweat, and people could get healed. Think about that. The Holy Spirit is able to heal just by someone's sweat beads. Wouldn't that be awesome? Man, if people could get healed by my sweat, we'd have an amazing recovery of all this. But I sweat like crazy. I'd go up to the hospital and say, here, just rub my armpit, man. You'll get better. You know, I'm just saying, this is the Spirit's not limited to anything. So we don't need to go around saying, man, I wish the Holy Spirit still can do amazing things in different ways in your life. If you rely upon Him rather than your form or function. And this continues. a father's discernment. Verses 13 to 17. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists, like the seven sons of Sceva, attempted to pronounce the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirit. And the evil spirit answered them, I know Jesus, I recognize Paul, but who are you? And then we got the very humorous strip naked tar kicking contest that happened. Okay, and this is really kind of a humorous little scene. I'm telling you, this is really fun. But here's the thing about this. Father's discernment. There are going to be people who are going to try to pass themselves off as godly when they're not. The godless will try to appear to be godly. And a father has to discern that, to know that these are not legit people of God, that these are wolves in sheep clothing, that there are people that are going to walk around trying to use God as a means to an end. And I had a great-grandpa, my great-grandpa Westover. I never got to meet him. He died when I was just an infant. But I was told that he had a phrase that said, you only can fake it for so long. So a father has to be patient in his discerning process. Because there are people that are going to try to use Jesus as a means to an end. In other words, they're going to say, my goal is these things, and I want to follow Jesus so that I can achieve this goal. Therefore, their goal is not Jesus, their goal is that goal. You know who those people are? They're the ones that tend to say, I went to church and I tried that for a while, but it didn't work. What that meant was their goal wasn't God. Their goal was something else they wanted God to give them. And when it didn't happen, they bailed. Okay, so that there has to be that type of absolute discernment. And there are even some people that will pretend to be Christian in order to get into a Christian person's bed. That they will pretend and they will live that life for so long in order to sleep with someone. In fact, this was a theme that was actually brought about in a really stupid little movie called Bubble Boy, Jake Gyllenhaal's first film. Here's a movie that's not worth watching, but it's an interesting moment where he's in love with this girl, but this other guy wants to sleep with her, but she will only sleep with whomever it is she marries. And so the guy, for 2 years, lives a lie, sleeping with all these other women on the side, but trying to live this lie in order to get her to marry him so he can sleep with her, and then he's going to dump her. And so it shows that even Hollywood in its secular forms understands that there are wolves out there. And their goal is conquest. Their goal is to look godly, if you will, in order to get what they want. And so a father's discernment is absolutely, absolutely necessary. And there are some that will end up trying, some teenagers will know that discernment is an issue here and that they're dealing with a wolf, and then they'll try to excuse it. They'll try to justify it. They'll say something, I heard one that was really stupid online, and I just wanted to go, that's so stupid. And I know that word's not going to win them over, and so I try to use logic and reasoning, even though they obviously are not. But nonetheless, I had someone say, well, you know, it's okay that this person, I'm dating this person, I'm going to sleep with this person, because after all, Jesus had Judas and his team, so I can have Judas on mine. To which my reply was, do you not realize that Judas was chosen and allowed intentionally for the sake of betrayal and crucifixion, death and torment? And isn't that something you would probably go without? It should be our goal to not be tortured and betrayed. It should be our goal to not experience that. And it's definitely a parent's goal for the children not to experience torture and betrayal. So it's weird that people will try to justify themselves. And a parent needs to be discerning so that when they see that person, because I'm telling you, no one influences you more than the friends you choose and the person you want to marry. Okay, there is so much influence there. And the people who are making those friendships are more blind to it than those on the outside. And it becomes a really interesting battle. So that's why I have decided to try to engage my children first. To try to beat it at the pass, especially Ziva. So Ziva and I go out on daddy-daughter dates. And we go out and we do things, just her and I. And I talk to her what it means that a guy should open the door for you, a guy should pray with you when you eat, and a guy should... And we talk about what it means to date. And it's not that I'm trying to create a romantic date with my daughter, not that at all, but I'm teaching her what a good guy does. So that if a guy tries to be anything different, she goes, well, aren't you a slob, and leaves him. and doesn't go out with them. You know, that's kind of, I'm trying to beat that off at the pass there, right off the get-go. And I'm with my son, we're doing the kind of like the opposite. We're teaching what it means to open the car door for someone, and that this is what we do. And we're trying to teach them how to be a good guy on a date, and then teach them chivalry, and teach them, you know, that, okay, it's going to be your job to pray, and you're going to have to pray. And so we try to work with that with them a little bit, and on that begins to go. But we're trying to beat it off at the pass, because I know there's wolves out there. And it's not just men trying to get women. There are girl wolves, too, after men. There's even adult women. They're called cougars, but that's a different story. Okay, but there are wolves on both sides. And a parent has to be discerning. We need to be discerning that the godless will try to pass them off as godly. And then lastly, a father's life and a father's legacy. From verses 18 to 20, the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified, and many who had become believers came confessing and disclosing their practices. Many of those who had practiced magic collected their books and burned them in front of everyone. In this way, the Lord's message flourished and prevailed. Let me just be honest here. A father's life, a father's legacy should be to instill repentance in others. That when other people come in contact with that individual, they start recognizing what it means to be godly and that they're not there. And that they have the desire to repent and to have life change. That it should instill that. Another way of putting this, to kind of paraphrase C.S. Lewis a little bit, a father should be willing to get right to the gates of hell and trip people so that some might be dragged to salvation from it. That a father should be willing to get just right next to the open flames, tripping people, and then grabbing them to repentance. That type of an attitude. That a father's life just instills that idea of repentance. Let me just share with you how this doesn't just have to be for your children. This can be for your children's friends. Because one thing I've learned about kids, they have friends over. Over to the play yard or over into the house and playing in their room or whatever. In fact, about a year and a half ago, my daughter had a friend over. A young girl was playing with her. It was in the house. And this is just to show you the impact this can have. About 5 to 7 minutes into play time. And I get involved in the play. I don't play with them. I let them play, but I help them. And sometimes I'll get involved and play with them, and I'll chase everyone around the house or whatever. I'll get out a water gun and, you know. I shot my mom the other day, and she yelled at me and said words I haven't heard since an Eddie Murphy show. But no, not quite like that. But, you know, but I have fun with kids because I'm a kid at heart. But here's the thing. They were just playing, and I was just talking, making sure everything was provided for. About 5 to 7 minutes into playtime, the other girl told Ziva, she said, "Your daddy's really nice, and your daddy, he really loves you. He's nothing like my dad." Okay, and so kids notice things. Even though I wasn't on my knees playing at that moment, kids notice things. And I heard that. I was just across the room, and I heard her say that. And I just was like, wow. Began dawning on me. I've always been told about how kids notice things we never realize. But it never really clicked about other people's children noticing things. And that there could be children out there who don't know what it means to have a good dad. And it doesn't mean we go around adopting everybody, but it means we can be that image of a good dad and that people can be in our presence and recognize what it means to be a godly person, a godly parent, a good parent. They can notice that. They can see that. They can have that example displayed in front of them. Think of it like this. I don't know if you ever really realized this or not, but our concept of fatherhood and how our parent was influences very greatly how we understand and comprehend God the Father. Think of it like this. We learn the concept of father before we ever learn about God the Father. It always goes from human to God first in our understanding, because as we grow up, we learn mama, dada first. We don't learn God first. Because the moment that child, when my son was born, the moment he came out of my wife, the first thing he saw was light and scary things. And then he saw a nurse with a towel and the scissors. And then after that, the next 2 hours straight was in my arms as my wife was out cold because she had 24-hour delivery. Okay, so 2 hours straight, he was wide-eyed just staring at me. Now, he's cried ever since the time he saw me since. But beside the point, but he just looked at me. And I think because he went, it's your fault. It's all your fault. 2 hours, I see your face, and this sucks, so it's your fault, you know, maybe. But anyway, I'm holding him in my arms. And so he learns Father before he ever learns God the Father, which means God the Father is going to be influenced by and partially shaped from how he understands me. My daughter, same way. And if I screw something up, which likely I will, I think Ziva might think God might be mentally unstable. I'm not sure. Because I do weird things. She goes, Daddy, you know. But if someone has a miscued or a screwed up understanding of God the Father because their father on earth failed them in some way, they can get glimpses of what the good dad and the great God the Father looks like based upon how we interact with them, even if they're not our kid. And if you've screwed up in the past and you say, man, I've not been the dad I'm supposed to be, well, as long as you still got breath in your lungs, guess what? If you rely not upon your form and your function, but you rely upon the Holy Spirit, you can teach the proper attitude of what it means to be God the Father from this point forward. That repentance can still happen. That change can still take place. And so what I've done is I actually have a list of the top 10 ways that many dads have failed their children. Stuff like, doesn't listen to my concerns. I didn't feel like he forgave my failures. I didn't think he was safe to be around. Didn't provide for my needs. Does not discipline in love, but rather out of anger. Doesn't relate well to my mom or to the church. Wasn't a benevolent spiritual leader. Was not emotionally appropriate. Didn't keep his words. Was not respected or successful. And what I have are verses of the Bible attached underneath one to show you how if your dad failed in these areas, here's how God has succeeded perfectly in those exact areas. So if you had a father on this earth who failed you, you can see how God the Father is not like that dad. And everybody can take a list of this home and see what God the Father perfectly looks like despite the failings of our earthly father. And dads, if you are trying to figure out how to change in these ways, read these verses. And let it instill upon you the attitude of repentance in those areas as you get to see how God the Father is amongst those categories. So we'll have that available for you at the end of the service. I just want to be able to wrap this up and to close it off by saying, dads, parents, look at these four lists, these four items on your list. What is your passion? And yes, you can have many passions in your life. You have sports as a passion? Absolutely. Movies? Absolutely. But is God your chief passion? Second, what's your reliance? Do you rely upon form and function, or are you trying to rely upon the Holy Spirit? How do you pray? Do you pray that God gives you a pay raise, or do you pray that God fills you more with his power for his glory? How do you pray? What's your discernment? Are you really involved in the life and education and social networking, you know, of your family and your kids, discerning what is godly and what isn't? Are you worried about what shows they're watching, what is influencing them in the way toward God, and what is influencing them away from God? What's your discernment level? And lastly, what's your life and legacy? Do you instill repentance in the life of others? Do people look upon you and say, I got a glimpse of what it means to be a godly person, and I want to know more about this Jesus? What's your legacy? Can people look at you and your house and say that you serve the Lord?